So updatable views is nothing but using view, you can update the data of the underlying table. Sure, tell me.
By using select query, we are viewing the table. Then what's the use of view separately?
Yeah. Yesterday I talked about it in the video, so I will request you to go through the video, okay, and then you will be able to understand. But for now, the reason we have this view is, okay, the definition, let's say if we have a lot of data in this table, okay, address ID, address line, and then student ID, and then geography ID, and then let's say there is another column which is related to the person, okay, some secure information. Let's say I have SSN column here, okay, or let's say I have a date of birth column which I don't want to share it with everyone in the company or in the application, okay, wherever I am trying to use this table. Okay, so for that reason, if I want to restrict access to one of the column or few columns in the table, how can I do it? I can do it by giving certain access to this table. Okay, actually we can specify when we are trying to create access to a particular login, we can specify access to a particular column, we can give access to a particular table, okay, we can do all that specifications when we will talk about that when we do our administration part, okay, giving access to a table or giving access to a specific column or something like that, okay, but then that will be a more tedious work, okay, because if you have to give access to multiple people which are in multiple groups, then you have to give that kind of logic, you have to put that kind of logic for each user or each group, okay. Instead of that, what we can do is we can create the view, and then inside this view we will select only those columns which we want to display to the users or which are okay to be displayed, okay. So for that kind of for that reason, we can create a view, and then we can ask all the users to use the view, and then for address table directly we will not give access to any of the persons, we will just deny access to this table. That way all the developers in your company and all the applications in your company will just try to use this view instead of the address, okay. So that's one of the main reason, but then there are other reasons also, so try to watch the video and then it will be able to help you. Okay, so updatable views is when we are trying to update the view, basically we are trying to update the underlying table data, okay, so that's how the data is updated. Now let's say in this table if we want to update geography ID, can I update using view, this view? No, because the geography ID I did not put inside this view. That means there is no geography column in this view. Alright, that's the reason it doesn't allow us to update this particular column. Let's say GRY underscore ID. Let's say I want to put it as 100 or something. Okay, it says invalid column name because that column we are not using inside this view definition, okay, so only those columns which you use in the view definition, only those can be updated, okay. And then one more thing is, let's say my view definition is like where student ID is equal to, let's see what data I have here, student ID 2, let's say I'll take student ID 2. Okay, so now if I run my view, address ID is equal to 2, or let's say student ID is equal to 4, okay, So now my view will have this data, address ID 2, address ID line, I mean address lines, same address, and then student ID 4. Okay, so this is the record that my view is giving. So if I want to update my, I mean the address table, sorry, this view, okay, and then let's say I put geography ID as 100, it doesn't allow me to update this column. Okay, so let's say I'll try to change this address ID, or let's say address line equal to new address line. Now you can see only one record got affected, and then if you look at the table data, you can see only student ID 4, the details of student 4 got updated. Okay, because whenever you are trying to update the data through view, then it will follow the conditions whatever you are putting in your view definition. Okay, so you cannot update other records which are not showed by the view. Okay, you can just update only that data which will which the view shows to you. Okay, so that's how the updatable views work. And then not all the data cannot be updated. Okay, let's say if I am trying to have address ID here, instead of address ID I can use, let's say, count of address ID, as we will talk about what is count. Okay, but then I'm trying to make my query a little bit complex. Okay, so I try to change this definition. Now if I try to change the address ID is equal to 100 or something, now it says invalid column name address ID. Okay, basically even if I put address ID here, we will talk about all these group bys in future, but I just want to make my view definition a little bit complex. Okay, so if I try to update this, it says cannot update the view because it contains aggregates or distinct or group by clause or pivot or unpivot. Okay, so basically what I mean to say is, whenever you create a view, the definition of the view should be simple. Only in that case the data gets updated using the view. Okay, if you write if you use some group by clauses, or if you use some distinct clauses or some other things which will make your query a bit complex, okay, in that case it doesn't update the underlying data. Okay, only simple statements are, simple statements are given inside the view definition, only then you can do your update. Alright, so that's your updatable view. And then we'll talk about partitioned view. Okay, partitioned view is nothing but I have this data, right? Let's say I have Let's quickly create this. Okay, and then I'm just, for simplicity purpose, I'm just putting one column. You can have multiple columns. Okay, I have three tables here. Now I'm inserting some data into these tables. Okay, now I have the data in all these three tables. Okay, so this table stores my customers which are enrolled in the year 2014. Okay, and then this table has 2015 year customers, and then this table has 2016 year customers. Okay, so now I have three different tables. There may be different reasons for having these three different tables. One, the first reason which we can think of is, let's say there's a lot of customers which are trying to enroll in 2014 or in each year. Okay, so I don't want to put all the customers in one table. Okay, because of various reasons, so I divided my data into multiple tables. Okay, or you can say there is a, instead of this, you can say there is a customers table for Texas state. Okay, Texas customers, and then for Illinois customers, and then let's say for New Mexico customers. Okay, the other reason which I can say is these three tables. My application for Texas customers is different, and then for Illinois customers is different, and then New Mexico customers is different. Okay, even if the application is same, let's say I have created three different tables to divide my data separately. Okay, and then one more reason is also, like, let's say you own a company. Okay, and then you have a customers table. Okay, let's say you bought a new company. Okay, so the new company will also have some database. Okay, so that database also have some customers table. Okay, so now you want to import that new company's customer table into your database. Okay, which you have done. Okay, and then you can't put everything in your customers table for various reasons. Okay, so that for that reason you created two tables, one for your own company and one for the company which you bought. Okay, so now you have basically two tables or multiple, more than one table. Okay, so now when you are using your when you are trying to create an application where you want to show your customers data, okay, what you want to where you can get your customers data. Okay, you can use this table, you can use this table, you can use this table. Okay, if you want to get all the combined customers, then you have to combine all this data. Okay, so what you will have to do, select star from ...2014, and then you will say union all. Similarly, select star from 2015. ...2016. Okay, so this query will get you all the customers. Okay, so every time in your application, instead of using all this big code, what you can do is you can just put that code in your definition. And then you can just create it as customers. Okay, now if you just run your view, which will get all the data from all these three tables. Okay, so this is nothing but it's a partitioned view. That means your table data is in multiple places, so you are just combining that data. This kind of query, when you are using inside the view, it is called partitioned view. Okay, nothing else than that. All the other rules will remain the same. And then see, you have these three tables. Okay, so this is a bit of complex, so you cannot update your data like this. Okay, you cannot update the data using view, because which table you want to update the data? You can't update the data in all three, right? So that's the reason when you are trying to update your data, the view definition should be as simple as possible. And then we will talk about index views. Okay, what is an index view? Okay, so the main difference which I said is the table is a physically, table stores data physically on a data file, whereas view doesn't store the data physically, does not have the data stored. Okay, but so where it gets the data from? Basically, every time you say select star from view, the query inside the view will be running, and then it will get you the data. But the data is not stored anywhere. Every time you run your view, it will run this particular query in the back end. Okay, so whatever columns you are putting here, those are the columns for your view. Whatever the data is coming from this query, those are the records for this view. Okay, so that's why I call a view as a logical table. Okay, logical table means it doesn't store the data anywhere, but then it gets the data from the query inside the view definition. Okay, so table stores the data physically, whereas view doesn't store the data physically. Okay, let's say I have created some complex logic. Okay, something like, let's say I have select count star count what did I put customer ID as count something like this. Okay, basically I have created a query inside this view in such a way that it does some lot of calculations, lot of aggregations. Okay, so if I have that kind of view which is doing lot of calculations, what does that mean? Whenever I try to run this query, all these calculations are done every time. Okay, if you run this view 10 times, all these calculations are done 10 times. Okay, maybe if that's taking some time, okay, because it has to do all the aggregations every time the view is run, it will take some time. So to avoid that time, to make it run faster, you will have to store this view data. That means whatever you are running this data, you want to store it. Once it does all the calculations, you want to store it. If that data is stored, then if you run this view, it will get you the data faster because it doesn't have to do calculations. The calculations are already done and stored in the database. Okay, for that reason you have to store the data for a view. Okay, but by default a view doesn't store the data. So to make it to store the data, you have to create a index on that particular view. Okay, so we know two types of indexes, clustered index and non-clustered index. What does clustered index do? Clustered index, when created on a table column, okay, then it will physically arrange the data in the table, or it will physically change the order of the data according to ascending or descending, right? So similarly, so basically what is cluster index doing? It is working with the data. Okay, and then non-clustered index, it doesn't have anything to deal with the data. Okay, it will create a separate structure in your database. Okay, and then it will have connections to the data files. Okay, so for that reason, on a view, first we have to create a clustered index. We have to create unique clustered index. Okay, unique clustered index, and what is the name which I want to give? CIX underscore, and then let's say I will give this view name. Okay, on this particular view. Okay, on this view, and then on which column you want to create the clustered index for this view? Count one column. Okay, now, okay, it says cannot create the clustered index because it needs to be schema bound. Schema binding. It says we should use the correct database, the table name format. We should use two-part format. That means we have to specify the table name also, sorry, the schema name also. Okay, now I have binded that view to these tables. Okay, what does schema binding means? Schema binding is nothing but when you are trying to create this view, you have these, you have used these three tables, okay, and then you have used customer ID column. Okay, let's say some person is trying to drop this column from this table. What happens to your view? Your view will start failing. Okay, so for that reason, in order for the view to be successful every time, we will bind these tables which are used inside the view with the view. That means no other person can make changes to this table in such a way that it will affect the view definition. Okay, so you cannot change the structure of the tables which will affect the view definition, that is specified by schema binding. Okay, now I will try to create this. There is one more like this. You cannot do union, intersect or except operators when you are trying to create your index. That's one more limitation we have with the view. Okay, so let's remove that, and then let's say I have done some aggregations here. Okay, and then now I'll try to change that particular view, and let's create this one. What? Come on. Cannot create index on view because its a select list does not include a proper use of count big. Consider adding count big star to the list. Okay, now we have created this view, sorry, the clustered index on the view. Okay, so now your query runs faster. That means it's storing all your aggregated data instead of regular data. Okay, so only in some cases, only in very few cases, you will be creating this clustered index view. Okay, what are those cases? If your definition of the view is a bit complex, okay, that means it's trying to do some calculations. Okay, so in order to avoid these calculations to be done every time, you will do it once and then store it in a table. Okay, or store it in a place. Okay, so once you create this clustered index on the view, now the data is stored for this view. Okay, so I'll try to delete this clustered index. Okay, so I drop the clustered index. Now I will see space used. Okay, so you can see there are zero number of rows, there is no reserved data, there is no index, nothing. Okay, so now if I try to create the index for this view and then run this stored procedure, you can see there is one row, there is reserved data, there is index size. Okay, so that means the data is stored for this view. Okay, so that's nothing but indexed view. It's also sometimes called as materialized view. That means the index is created on this particular view and the data is stored in your database. Okay, so once you have clustered index on this view, you can create non-clustered indexes also. Okay, on this view you can create non-cluster index also, because you have data pages now for this view, you have data pages. Okay, now you can create non-cluster indexes depending upon your criteria. Okay, so without a cluster index, can you create a non-cluster index on this view? No, because only if you create a clustered index, the data gets stored. If you don't have data pages, how can you create index, and then how it will be useful? A non-clustered index. Okay, so you have to have a clustered index for the view to create a non-clustered index. Okay, so first you have to create clustered index, and only then you can create non-clustered index for further requirements. Okay. Okay. Now we will talk about triggers. What are triggers? These are all different database objects in SQL Server. Okay, like tables, views, triggers, functions, stored procedures. Okay, there are a lot of other database objects. Okay, eventually you will be using all these features or database objects to make a SQL program. Okay, or to maintain your database or to develop an application. Okay, so what are triggers? Triggers are nothing but it's a database object, or you can say it's a SQL program which is executed automatically when an event occurs. Okay, so trigger is nothing but it's a SQL program which is executed automatically when an event occurs. Okay, we know what is a SQL program. It can be anything. It can be an insert statement, it can be a update statement, or a delete statement, any kind of statement. Okay, when I say executed automatically, we don't have to execute it. Okay, when something happens on your database, okay, this SQL program is executed. What is that something? That something is nothing but event. When an event occurs on your database, okay, then this particular SQL program is executed. That is called trigger. Okay, so now what are these different events? What is this event? Okay, it may be any DML operation, okay, or DDL operation. Okay, or log on operation. Okay, so what is a DML operation? DML is nothing but insert, update, delete. Okay, so let's say someone is trying to delete the data from the table, customer's table. Let's say they are trying to delete the data, or there is a credit card table, and then someone is trying to delete the credit card history or the available credit amount. Okay, so when that kind of thing happens, you want to make sure what's happening. Okay, and then who is doing it, and then you want to store the history. Okay, and or let's say if someone is trying to update the customer name. Okay, or if someone is trying to update the salary of a particular person. Okay, which if you don't want the persons to do that, right? Let's say if that person has an update permission to update the salary, but you don't want to do it by person. Okay, you have a different logic which everything should be done in a logical way. Okay, so for that reason, what you will do is, if someone is trying to do an update or delete or insert which you don't want them to do, then you will try to fire a trigger, and then in that trigger you will say just roll back the statements. That means whoever is trying to delete, capture his information and also don't do anything. That means whatever they are trying to run the query, it will not get affected on the database. So you are rolling back the operation of that particular person. Okay, so you can do that kind of things using trigger. So whenever someone is trying to delete the data from customer's table, a trigger is fired, and then that will not allow the changes to happen, and it will also show the message to the person saying that you cannot do this, or you can capture that particular person's information and then store it in a log file. Okay, or you can send out an email to your company saying there was a delete statement run on this particular table, something like that. You can do all these kind of things. Okay, what is a DDL operation? Okay, DDL means the kind of event is when creating a database. Okay, or dropping a database. When somebody is trying to drop a database, you don't want that to happen. Okay, so you will try to create a trigger saying if someone is trying to drop my database, just roll back the operation and then send out an email to all the DBAs or just log that particular information. Okay, so all the kind of DDL activities, that means creating database, dropping database, alter database, or creating a table, creating a view, all kind of structure related thing is DDL, right? So that is DDL operation. And DML is when you are working with the data, delete, update and insert. Okay, and then what is log on operation? Log on operation is nothing but when someone is trying to log into your SQL server. Okay, let's say there are already 100 connections on my computer. That means 100 connections mean 100 people are already connecting to my database, and I know that if my database connections crosses 100 connections, then my database performance will go down. Okay, so what I want to do, I don't want any connections more than 100. So I'll try to create a trigger saying that if my connections are more than 100, just roll back the extra connections. That means don't give access to other connections. Okay, so and then let's say if someone is trying to log into your SQL server, you want to capture that particular person's user ID. Okay, you can capture it, and then you can also capture at what time he logged into SQL server and then put it in the log table. Okay, so these kind of operations you can do with the help of your triggers. Okay, so trigger is nothing but you will write a SQL program which will execute automatically when one of these operations, one of these events occur on your database. Okay, so that is a trigger. It will do automatically. We don't have to do it manually. Okay, so we will try to see one by one how do we create these triggers on all these different types of actions. Let's say I have a table. Let's see if we have student information table. Okay, I have all this data. Okay, now I want to create a trigger when someone is trying to update the any column in this particular table. Okay, if someone is trying to update any column in this table, then I want to store that, let's say if someone is trying to change Bob. Okay, I want to store that Bob information in my history. Okay, so that way the new update will happen, but then I have the old data. Okay, so I'm trying to log the history. Okay, whatever the changes are happening to this table, I am trying to log it in my history table. Okay, so for that reason, I'll try to create a history table. So the shortcut which I can use to create a new table which is having the same structure of this table is select into this table. Okay, apart from these columns, star means all these columns, and apart from all those columns, I also want to create another column called let's say I'll put it as get date as modified timestamp. Okay, so now I need to give a new name, history. Okay, so the new table has been created with the same structure with an extra timestamp column. Okay, so this is my data, and then I'll just remove this data. Okay, now I have this new table which I can store all the information or all the history of this old table. Okay, so now how do I do that? I want to create a trigger. So the syntax goes this way: create trigger, and then what is the trigger name? TR underscore, and then I'll put this name, that way I know this is the trigger related to this table. Okay, so create trigger name on this table. Okay, sorry, for update. Okay, that means for update means whenever an update event occurs, and this is your event type. Okay, so for update as begin and end, and then you write your program here. Okay, so let's say you are trying to update anyone is trying to update this particular table. Okay, then you want to store the data for into this table. Okay, and then what all you want to store, whatever information is being updated in this table, right? Student info table, whatever people are trying to update, that information I want to store it. Okay, so what happens when someone is trying to update, okay, when an update occurs on this table or any table for that matter, what happens is it will, the update statement will try to create some two tables, okay, temporary tables, okay, or staging tables. Okay, whenever you run an update statement, two tables are created, okay, which doesn't show up here. They are just for temporary purpose. Okay, what those tables are called? Inserted and deleted. Okay, so what does this inserted and deleted means? Okay, let's say you have a customer name called Robert. Okay, so you are trying to update this particular value. What happens is it will try to create an inserted table. Okay, and then in the inserted table it will store Robert, that means old information. Okay, and it will, sorry, not here, that's for insert. Okay, so what happens is it will store this Robert's information in the deleted table. Okay, that because when you are changing Robert to John, okay, when you are changing Robert to John, what happens, this is your old data and this is your new data, right? So basically this value is stored in deleted table, that means this value is getting deleted. Okay, that's why that value is stored in deleted table, and then this is inserting into this place, right? So this John is stored in inserted table. Okay, so whenever you are trying to run an update statement on this particular data, okay, this value gets deleted and then stored in deleted table, and this value comes into this place. So it's trying to, so basically it's trying to do two operations. One is deleting the value and inserting the value. Okay, so these are the two temporary tables which stores that information when it's performing that update operation. These two are temporary tables, and then they are not stored in your database, but they are stored in the memory. Memory is nothing but RAM. Okay, so these two tables will have that information. Okay, so now since this table deleted, right, so if you say select star from deleted, that means this temporary table, since it has that data, that data I am inserting into this history table. Okay, so and then in deleted data it will have all this column information. Okay, when you are trying to delete this table, it will have all this column information. Okay, so now I said select star from deleted, that means all columns, and apart from that, student information history also has modified timestamp column, right? So I want to say get date, okay, as modified timestamp. Okay, so this is the query which runs and during the time of update. Okay, so now if I say, and then the trigger should be executed, the trigger statement should be the very first statement in the batch. That's the reason if you didn't put go, you see there's a red mark. Okay, so if you should always have your trigger as a first statement in the batch. Okay, because go is the batch separator, so this is a separate batch, and then this will be your separate batch. Okay, so you don't want to write that. You can just select this query. If you are selecting all this query, then it will give you an error, because it should be the very first statement after the batch. Okay, now I'm creating this trigger on this table for update. Whenever update happens to this table, okay, all the data will be stored in the deleted table, right? So from that table, I am storing it into my permanent table, history table. Okay, so let's try to create this trigger. Okay, it says student information history can only be specified. There's an identity column to this table, student information history table. Okay, so if you look at this history table, you can see there is an identity column, student ID. Okay, so the student ID is an identity column. So that means the data gets automatically inserted into this table or into this particular column. Okay, so for that reason, what I will do, I'll try to say set identity insert on. Okay, and then once the insert is happened, I'll just put it off. Okay, we talked about this identity property, if you remember. Okay, so now if I try to create this trigger, okay, it also needs the column list. This is your, sorry. Student ID, first name, last name, age, created by, and modified timestamp. Okay, now let's create this. Hopefully it should work this time. Okay, so it says command completed successfully. That means we have created this trigger. Where you can see this trigger? You can see this trigger because this trigger is created on this table. You should open this table and then you can see triggers, and then you can see the trigger. Okay, you can always script this trigger. Okay, so now this is your trigger. Now what does it do? Let's try to update the data in this table. Okay, so this table now I have, let's see what data I have in this table. Okay, so now I have all these students. I want to update Robert's information. Okay, I'll say where student first name is equal to Robert. I just want to run my query. Okay, I'm sure that's the only record I have. Now I will try to update this table, set student first name is equal to John. Okay, so I'm trying to update this particular statement. Okay, and then my trigger should get fired. Once I run this query, my trigger should get fired, and it's allowing me to run this update, because nowhere I said don't run the update. Okay, I said whenever an update is happening, try to store that particular information. Okay, whatever it has deleted or whatever the old data was there, store it before getting the new values. Okay, so if I try to run this, you can see the rows affected, and then if you look at your student info table, Robert, there were two Roberts, maybe. Okay, so the Roberts, no, this was already John. Okay, so this only, there was one record, Robert Deland was only one record, so it updated Robert's first name to John. Okay, so this record got updated. Now let's go ahead and see in our history table what it stored. Okay, you can see that at that time this was your old information. Okay, and then let's say if you try to update where last name is equal to DLAN, I am trying to update Robert's first name as let's say Mike. Okay, now if you try to see the first name has changed to Mike. Now if you look at your history table, see Robert and John. Okay, that means the combination of these two tables, you can say student ID 3, okay, student ID 3 here. So at 2014 12 30 at 8:47 the information was updated from the information before that. The information was Robert, that means before that the first name was Robert, and at 8:48 the information was John. Okay, and now the current information is Mike. So you have stored all your history, that means however your data is changing, you stored all that information. Okay, so one example where you can find this scenario is, let's say you are changing the price of a product. Okay, so you will have to store what was the history of that product's price. Okay, so you can create a trigger and then you can store all the past history of that particular price. Whenever the price changes, you have your trigger fires, and then your old price will be saved in your history, because you don't want to lose the history of your price for a product, right? So for that reason you can use this particular triggers. Okay, and similarly for update, right, you can also specify for update or insert or delete. Okay, you can specify all of these. Okay, so you can specify all of these, either update happens or insert happens or delete happens. Then let's say instead of writing all this code, now I want to roll back my transaction. That means I don't want these particular statements to be happening. Okay, so now I'll try to change my trigger definition. Now if I try to, let's say from Mike I'm trying to change to or let's say we already have Bob, Tom. Okay, and then now if I try to run this, you can see the transaction ended in the trigger, the batch has been aborted. Okay, now if you look at your data, it's still Mike, it doesn't, the update statement did not run. Okay, even if you did an insert to this table, it will not run. Even if you did a delete to this table, it will not run. Instead it will give you a message saying the trigger is fired and then the statement has been aborted. Okay, you can also say another message, cannot print is nothing, but it will try to print a statement. Okay, whatever you want to show, whatever you want to display the message to the person. Okay, cannot update or delete or insert into with this table. You want to show some custom message. Okay, you can do that. See, cannot update or delete or insert with this table. Okay, so you can do a lot of things with these triggers. Okay, once you know how these triggers are useful. Okay, so this is for, that means you are saying when it's trying to do update, insert or delete, it will first finish this action. That means it will first do the update, it will do the insert or it will do the delete, and it will roll back the transaction. That means first it will try to do this, okay, and it will roll back. If you said commit, that means it will commit the transaction. That means whatever is happening here, it will do it permanently. Okay, if you roll back, we will talk about this rollback, all these transactions, okay? But rollback transaction is nothing but it will, the last statement which is done, okay, it will be rolled back in this particular scope, okay? So it rolled back, we saw that, okay? So that is for, that means these actions will be performed, these actions will be performed and it will be rolled back, okay? It's, if I say instead, then it doesn't do anything, it will not update. Instead of doing update, it will do it rollback transaction or any other thing which we put it here, okay? So that's the difference between for and instead. For means first it will do it, it will allow this particular thing to be done, but it will later, in the next moment, it will try to roll back this transaction. Instead means it would, all these will not be done, sorry, all these will not be done, but instead of that, whatever you write here, that will be done. Any questions on that? So that is your DML operation, okay, or DML trigger. It's also called as DML triggers. And then we have DDL triggers. DDL triggers, I said, it's created to restrict DDL operations or to allow DDL operations or to log DDL operations, okay? So let's say I don't want anyone to drop a database, okay? So I will have to create, so for this DML trigger, I can just drop it, okay? So drop trigger name on this table and then drop it. Okay, just the drop trigger and trigger name. Now let's say I want to create my DDL trigger. So create trigger tr underscore don't drop table. Okay, so DDL trigger is nothing but you can you can do it on events such as creating table, dropping a table, altering a table, and then similarly for view, and then similarly for database also, okay? So create trigger name, and then let's say on database. Okay, so I don't want anyone to drop any table, okay? So create trigger name and then on database for drop table, okay? So this is how you specify drop table, or you can say alter table, or you can say create table, okay? You can specify one option or you can specify all these options, okay? Or you can similarly put in as view, create view, alter view, drop view, all these. There are a lot of options which you can use here, okay? So no one can drop a table. So I'll just remove these things as begin and end. And inside this, you will just say rollback transaction and you can specify any message. Okay, so now I'm trying to create this trigger on the database, okay? And then now if I try to create this, now try to drop any table. Let's say I want to drop this table. The transaction ended in trigger, the batch has been aborted, okay? So that's how this trigger, the DDL trigger, works, okay? And this trigger, you will be creating this on database, on a database level, okay, not a table level, okay? Now you can say this particular where you can see this particular trigger. The before DML trigger was related to one table, okay? So inside table you saw that trigger, but then this is a database level trigger. So where you can see, this is your database, and then if you go to programmability, you can see database triggers. you can see this. And then if you go to tables, and then if you see student info, and then under in student info table, you see this is table trigger and this is database trigger. Okay, so this is your trigger for not to drop any tables. Okay, and then let's say instead of database or instead of this drop table, I want to say no one can drop a database. Okay, so before that we will try to drop this drop trigger name on database. Okay, so that trigger is dropped, which we created just now. Now I'll try to create another trigger on, sorry, let's put it database, and then I want to say drop database. So when I'm saying drop database, I'm dealing with multiple databases. Okay, so I have to say on all server. Okay, because in server you have multiple databases, inside database you have multiple tables. Okay, so on all server, that means whenever you create a database, it's created on a server. When you create a table, it's created in a database. Okay, so that's the reason I'm saying here all server. And then try to create this, let's say drop database. Okay, now drop any database, let's say drop database. We will try to drop database training one. Okay, it says the transaction ended in trigger and the batch has been aborted. Even you cannot create a database if you write create database here. Okay, so however you create your trigger, based on that it will fire. And then where do you see this server level triggers? You can see here server objects, and then you can see triggers, and then that's the trigger, do not drop database. Okay, so there are three levels of triggers. One is you can create it on a table, that will be your DML trigger, and then you can create a DDL trigger on server level, okay, or on a database level. Alright, so we will drop that database, sorry, that trigger. Okay, now you can drop this training database, it works. Okay, if there is no trigger. And so that's basically DDL operation or DDL triggers. And then we have log on triggers. Log on triggers is nothing but whenever some person is trying to log in, then you can make him not to log in. Okay, for that I will have to create trigger tr and don't give access. Okay, on logins. Logins means, I said logins are always on server level, not a database level. Okay, we will talk about logins when we talk about administration. Okay, but if you remember, master database is a very important database for all the logon information. Okay, so if the master database gets corrupted, no one can log into SQL Server. Okay, so I'm trying to create this for a logon trigger. So on all server, you cannot create this on database. Okay, on all server for logon. Okay, and you will say as begin end. Okay, so if original login is equal to, or let's, because we didn't talk about logins here. Okay, so I have created a new person. Okay, actually I have given I have created a new login and gave access to that particular login. Okay, so let's try to create one more. I'll try to create a new login, and then I'm just trying to create a login, let's say for Tim. Okay, and then Tim doesn't have a Windows authentication because he doesn't have access to Windows. So I'll try to create SQL Server, and then I will put the password, and then password, and then I'll remove all these password policies for now, and then click OK. As simple as that. Okay, so now Tim will be able to, we have given access to Tim. So Tim will be able to connect to database engine using SQL Server authentication, and then let's say Tim, and then the password is Tim, and then click connect. Okay, now you can see the server instance, and then Tim has connected to this particular server. Okay, now let's disconnect Tim. Now if I say my original login is Tim, that means if Tim logged in, then I want to roll back transaction. That means I don't want him to log in. So I created this trigger. Okay, now where you can see this trigger, it's a server level. So you can see server objects, and then you can see triggers. You can see TR do not, sorry, refresh this one. TR don't give access. Okay, you can have multiple triggers, right? So this is the trigger we just created. And now let's try to give access to, let's try and see if Tim gets logged in. See, login failed for Tim due to trigger execution. Alright, so we did not give, we rolled back his login details, okay, or his authentication. We just rolled back his transaction. Now, let's say I will try to drop this trigger, and now let's try login as Tim. See, it worked. Right? So similarly, even if you give access, you can also capture Tim's information. Okay, or you can log when, at what time Tim logged in. Okay, so we can do that logging, or we can look at the number of connections. Okay, we will talk about connections, how to see connections. Okay, we can see how many connections are there by Tim, or total number of connections, and then we can say rollback. If the number of transactions is more than 100, just roll back that particular log, who that particular user whoever logged in after 100 connections. Okay, so basically those are all the triggers which we wanted to talk about triggers. Okay, so do you guys have any questions on triggers? Let's say your log table is somewhere in a different database. So you will say insert into the database name. Let's say the database name is logging_db. Dot, that's your database name. And dot the schema name, dot the table name. Log table. Okay. And then you can write your whatever you want to do. Okay. So basically you can insert the data into another table in a database, but then when you are trying to create a data, create a trigger, you have to create in that particular database where you want to fire it. All right. Yeah. So as I said, please.